So let's just start. I mean, you've had such a truly remarkable career. Could you walk us through it a little bit, please?
Sure. Well, I think Sue covered it pretty well. You know, it sounds also like formal and serious, you know, when somebody reads your bio. But I think my career has really been just a series of serendipity things, you know, that have happened. My first job I got because I happened to answer the phone when I was home on spring break, and it was the wife of the head of a huge retail chain, and she asked me about University of Texas, where I had went because her son was going there, and I told her all the things that I had done, and you know, then I got hired there. And then a sorority sister called me, who was at Coca-Cola, met her, and wound up being at Coca-Cola for a decade. But the best story is how I became the CEO of Spanx. No recruiters. You know, I didn't like call anybody that I knew. I was just shopping. And I was going to a party on Saturday night, and I had just had my third son and was still kind of fat from, you know, had a little baby weight, maybe is a nicer way to say it. And called this woman that I was mentoring in an organization and said, you know, I've been renovating the house. I still have this baby weight. What do I wear to this party? And she said that Spanx had just come out with control top fishnets. And I said, that's great. You know, you don't get grid butt from sitting on the fishnets, and it'll like, you know, tuck in my tummy a bit. And when I went to Saks to buy the fishnets, they were all sold out of the product in multiple sizes and colors. And as I was sitting there talking to the sales manager about supply chain management and vendor replenishment programs and why they should not be out of their fishnets, the founder of Spanx's boyfriend overheard me and started calling me on his cell phone, and that's how I became the CEO of Spanx. So you never know what can happen when you go shopping.
One of the things when you did that, you know, when you moved, you were at Coke and you had a very senior global position, and then you moved to Spanx. And it was, you know, a startup then, so it really was you took a risk. A lot of women, a lot of people in general, are nervous to take risks mm-hmm. in their career. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. You know, I think a close cousin to fear of failure is, you know, fear of taking risks. And I think that fear can, you know, take a hold of you in different ways. You know, sometimes it can stop you cold in your tracks and make you afraid to do the changes that you need to get yourself out of a certain circumstance. But fear can also incite a revolution because you're determined to make the changes that you need to. And I have always found that you know, inciting the revolution was a great way to go because it just, you know, makes you stronger. And as you look at things in a positive way and you say, you know, the only thing to fear is fear itself, we all know that expression, I think it's really true. And to me, I've always come out of any, you know, fearful situation saying all that means is that I care. You know, when I feel scared, if I'm sitting here before, you know, getting up to talk to all of you saying, I'm a little nervous about this. This is a big room of people. And it only means that I want to do a great job. And so you just have to move through that.
So that's a life lesson. I know you're very much about life lessons. So could you share a few life lessons with us that are particularly important?
You know, I think probably the thing that I always felt that maybe I wasn't so great about was I never thought I was a great listener. I was the oldest of three. My father was very serious about hard work and discipline, and we would sit at the table, the dinner table, every night, and he would have like this little pile of quarters next to, you know, his plate, and he would ask us questions. And it was like, talk about getting a stomach ache when you're eating, you know? And with my dad, it was like you had to have the right answer. And he would ask us random things like, you know, what animal has the longest lifespan, or, you know, what's the word for heaven in Greek mythology, or whatever they were. And he never asked a question that he didn't have the right answer to. And I really grew up learning that, you know, it was my job to always have the right answer. And as I progressed in my career, you know, I really realized that, you know, I was very determined to always think that there was one right solution to every problem and I was going to be the one to find it. And things, I think, happen and experiences happen that really change you. And one for me was a conversation that I had with a Native American woman. And I always joke and say, you know, it was supposed to have happened on a mountaintop in New Mexico at sunrise, but it was actually a hotel bar in Las Vegas. And she told me that in her culture, there was no such thing as truth. For any different question, there were 7 different answers. For any problem, there were shades of possibilities. And, you know, it really got me thinking, you know, was I so determined that I was going to find the right answer to the right question that I was really ignoring a lot of the information that was coming in and not being as great a listener as I could be. And once you realize that, you know, solutions can come from multiple places and those solutions can leave you in multiple directions, you know, life gets a lot easier. The solutions get better and, you know, you're in a much better place.
See, my dad is a philosopher, so at our dinner table, there were all these open-ended questions. No quarter could possibly, you could not win a quarter. Let's segue a little bit into change, because I think, you know, along the lines of risk, change is something that is scary to a lot of people. You're going through a change yourself, you know,
yes.
You've had one career, your path is changing. Could you talk a little bit about how that is affecting you and how to look at change?
Whenever you leave one thing to the next thing, you always have to let go of what came before. And I use the analogy of, you know, a trapeze bar. You know, we all want to hold on tight to the bar because if we let go, we're fearful we're going to fall to the ground. But what happens if you never let go is that, you know, you just kind of keep swinging back and forth, and you lose a lot of momentum. So I highly recommend, you know, when you're on the upswing, you know, letting go of the handle, the trapeze bar, even if you don't know that there's a second bar to catch at the time. You know, it's a great way to gain perspective and get your heart beating and, you know, really take time to, and take stock of, you know, what you want to do next. So leaving Spanx was just, you know, on an upswing. I mean, we had had our best year ever. I had had a wonderful time growing that company, taking it from a single product to multiple products to category leadership to, you know, having women from Savannah to Singapore, you know, wearing Spanx in 60 different countries. But I had to ask myself, you know, what was going to be the next 5 years like if I didn't leave? And I knew that my personal growth was going to start to decline. And, you know, like the trapeze bar, I was going to lose momentum. And I was having a breakfast with Mickey Drexler in Paris. And he kept saying, you know, what's your next gig? You know, what's going to be your next gig? And I kept thinking, but I'm just so happy where I am, you know. And I realized after that breakfast that, you know, it's really about challenging yourself that helps you to grow, and that even though I was happy, you know, that was not going to continue to be the case.
And you had said something interesting when we were talking before about change too, which is you change, but you can change again. So.
Exactly, yeah. The only thing that I think like you cannot go back on is having children. You know? I think kind of once you make that decision, you know, that's kind of a permanent decision. But besides that, I mean, there's almost anything that, you know, you can't change. You know, I change handbags and shoes all day long. And I am a proponent of change, but I, you know, I think you can't look at it so seriously that, oh my God, you know, this is like, if I do this, it'll be like forever. Like, it's really not forever. It could only be for a month. You know, I remember signing my first lease on an apartment and it was 6 months. And I said, oh my God, you know, how am I ever going to like get out of this? It's like 6 months. But I, you know, most things you can zig and zag and make a chicken scratch path. And if, you know, they're not going the way that you think they're going, you just adapt and move in a different direction.
So changing gears a little bit, in her opening remarks introducing you, Sue said, you know, who in this room probably isn't wearing Spanx? Well, you're probably not wearing Spanx. But
that is a big misconception, by the way. Extra smalls were one of our very best sellers.
Is that true?
It has absolutely nothing to do with size.
And that's really what I wanted to talk about women's insecurities. I think, you know, Spanx in so many ways, it addresses women's insecurities in regards to their looks. So I'm curious, how do you think being around this now, how do you think image, and perhaps more importantly, women's perceived images of themselves affect them in terms of success?
You know, people will come up to me sometimes and say, you know, you are just like the most confident person. You know, how can you just always be so confident? And like, I would just laugh and say, I am the most insecure, confident person you've ever met. I'm confident in my competencies. I'm confident that I can do the things that I say that I'm going to do. But, you know, we all have insecurities. And I really think that the insecurity is what drives you. It's the little engine that says, I can do better, I can do better, I can do better. I think with Spanx, you know, I really realized very early on that the brand was not at all about products. It was about building self-esteem. And if we could help women feel better in the clothes they wore by solving wardrobe problems for them, we could really change how they felt about themselves. And the magic, and all of you guys laughed when Sue brought up, you know, people wearing Spanx. And I always hear that, you know, so clearly that it's a giggle, right? And that giggle is because we were able to find humor and openness about talking about, you know, issues that you never talk about. Nobody ever, you know, talked about, you know, their pooch or their muffin top or grid butt or, you know, the outer banks of your bra. By really making it okay to the process of sharing, women got more confident about talking about their problem areas and not having it be this like shameful thing, you know, that they could never discuss. And I think that, you know, all of us as women, you know, when we unload, and men over there, I see a lot of men over there, you know, when you share a problem with somebody else, it all of a sudden lightens your load. And, you know, the person that you're talking to can say, oh my God, you're like worried about that? That's no big deal at all. And so I think it's about being open.
And admitting, you know, your insecurities.
Right.
And I think it's great to hear somebody like you who has been so successful say, listen, you know, I'm confident in myself, but at the same time, you know, I feel just as you all feel. And there's no question that the conversation about women has been extremely elevated in the last couple of years, especially with Lean In and just in so many different ways. You have a slightly different take on being a female CEO than what I was expecting when I first met you. Could you share your take about being a female executive with
yes.
everyone?
Okay, so I can't remember who it was, but somebody here, and when I was out in the pre-area reception, came up to me and said, "Yeah, I can't wait to hear your war stories about, you know, working in a male-dominated world and how bad they were." And I really have to answer that by saying I don't understand the question because it never happened to me. I worked at Coca-Cola. I was routinely, you know, the only woman in a room of guys, most of whom's wives did not work. And I just really never had that experience. I always felt that being a woman was this huge benefit. And it is really different. But as I talk to more and more women, it's like, you know, even though everybody, I totally believe in equal pay and equal rights. But what I don't think is that, you know, I should consider myself a female CEO before I consider myself a CEO. I want to be the best CEO I can be. I don't want affirmative action because I'm a female CEO. And as I talk to younger women, they really do not see it as much as maybe, you know, my generation did. Being with guys and figuring out how to work well with, you know, half of the population, you know, is really important. And this one woman came up to me and said, you know, I wish instead of going to all these women's group things, which can be very positive, and I love my women's group, so I'm not at all being negative about that. She said, but I felt like I missed some opportunities to also, you know, be with the guys doing their fraternity kind of things and understanding how I can get ahead. So I think that my point of view is not against equalness of women and women being all they can be, because we have such a wonderful advantage that we are so good at supporting each other. But I do think that we shouldn't look for problems. I think we should, you know, assume the sale, assume we're going to be accepted, that we are going to be fabulous, that we're, you know, going to get the job done, and not have in the back of our mind that somehow because we're a woman, you know, we aren't as good in some ways, because I think we're actually, you know, have an advantage.
I think that's an excellent point. And I also think your point, it's very important to have groups where we could talk, you know, women can talk amongst themselves. But as Laurie has said before, you know, you need to have more men as well. And it's great that there are some here, because otherwise you're in an echo chamber. You know, your way of thinking is very, very positive. But you mentioned, you know, you were in a room a lot of times with a bunch of men that, you know, had wives that didn't work. You feeling that way doesn't necessarily mean that the men that you're with feel that way and that they don't see you as a female CEO. Sheryl Sandberg says, act more like a man. Or that's what I took from Lena.
Right. I think act more like yourself. You know, we can clap
for
that.
That's great.
Yeah, I mean, I just want to, you know, be the best that I can be for myself, and I really don't spend too much time worrying about what the guys are thinking. I mean, if a guy's sitting there thinking, you know, he likes my dress, that's nice. I'm not offended by that. You know, I just think that we need to focus on getting the job done and being inclusive and getting along and diversity of ideas and being a good listener. And, you know, men and women, you know, it's been going on for a long time, but, you know, a lot of times we're kind of our best in front of each other too. You know, we help each other raise the game, and I think that's kind of a genetic thing that can happen, you know, too. So as you can probably tell, I'm a positive thinker. And, you know, that is, you know, that positive visualization of things going well and of having success at whatever we do, I think can overcome and be a much better way to deal with, you know, maybe perceived issues, maybe even if they're real issues. Maybe there are like three guys that are total pigs, you know, in the room. So don't deal with them. You know, still be the best that you can be and let them be the ones that have to change.
So one of the things about being a female CEO, however, is I know you're a mom to three boys and you're happily married and you're involved in philanthropy and mentoring and many, many things. So I'm going to ask you something which I know you already don't like, which is I'm very interested in work-life balance and how very successful women like you achieve some semblance of balance or whatever you would like to call it. So can you share that with us, please?
Okay, so there were these two dogs, and one was a puppy and one was an older dog. And the puppy says to the older dog, I have discovered something very interesting, that happiness is in my tail, and I am going to chase it and chase it and chase it until happiness is mine. And the older dog said, I agree with you that happiness is in your tail, but I have found that the more I chase it, the more it disappears. So I've also found that if I live my life the best way that I can, it follows me around. So I think that's what I've learned. I've learned that if you just live the best life that you can, happiness is the consequence. And, you know, when you get really, I call it holding on tight to the steering wheel, you know, you get like, I've got to accomplish everything, and oh my God, I have to do this by 11, and I've got to pick up my kids, and one of them's sick, and he's got to go to the doctor, but I have the PowerPoint presentation I've got to do, and I mean, you just get yourself like so worked up. There's no such thing as balance. I mean, every day, you know, stuff happens, right? You know, you wake up, you work from the minute you get up in the morning to the minute you go to sleep, at least I do, and it should be fun the entire time. And sometimes when I'm at work, I'm dealing with things that are happening at home. And there are many times that I'm at home dealing with things that are at work. And there's things that I'm learning from people in my philanthropy organizations that I take back to my family and my work. So it's just really a blending of seeing one life and making that life, you know, as happy and fulfilling as you possibly can. And I think that when you start trying to bucket things is when it gets more complicated. And that's why, you know, I think work and life, life is work and work is life. And so there, it's just one concept to me. It's not two different things.
So a lot of women that work very, very hard and have their personal life and their work life, they always are going through feeling a sense of guilt somewhere. Like you were saying, when you have so many things to do, are you able to sort of put that to the side?
I feel guilty all the time, but the guilt I think is just kind of like a DNA thing with, you know, with me. You know, I just heard somebody talking, and they were talking, it was actually my rabbi, it was at a sermon he gave over Rosh Hashanah last month, and he talked about, you know, things happening to people and that people either have, you know, one of three reactions to things when they go bad. Either they feel guilty, you know, I raise my hand, I'm the one that always feels guilty. You know, how could I have stopped the recession? I mean, I should have done something about that. Or, you know, they blame somebody else, you know, it's somebody else's fault, you know, it's like, you know, my husband can't work the computer. He's like, I can't believe that Apple made it this way. And I'm like, just click on the right over there, and, you know, so there are people that blame people, and then there are people that put their head in their sand and just, you know, kind of deny that, you know, they have a problem at all. So the feeling guilty is just, it's just, you know, some of us just have that, and that doesn't, you know, you just have to realize it's probably a chemical in your brain and not, you know, actually something that's, you know, external that's happening to you. And you know, that's why people take drugs.
So, oh.
Yeah, there are a lot of things that will cure guilt that, you know, if you take them. But I think mostly, you know, just focusing on, you know, not the extraneous stuff and, you know, relationships with people and accomplishing things that you're proud of.
So Arianna Huffington talks in her book Thrive a lot about finding ways to decompress. Mm-hmm. I interviewed her once and she said you have to gently escort your digital devices out of your bedroom in the evening. And I'm just curious, what is sort of the ways that you find you're able to decompress? Because as it turned out, you know, leaving Spanx didn't stop you from being really busy.
You know, some people say getting rid of your phone, you know, makes you relax more. I don't know, to me it might make me more stressful. Like, Sue, can you check my phone right now? It's in my purse right there and make sure I don't have any messages. I love to run. I've run my whole life. And that seems to, you know, be a time when I can just kind of decompress. But I mean, I will spend literally sometimes in an hour like looking at stuff on eBay. Like, I don't even know what it is that I really want. But there's just something relaxing about, you know, looking at it. It's commerce, so I look at it from a business perspective. I wonder how much this is going to sell for. I wonder who the woman is that's selling this. Why is she selling it? You know, that's a really cute dress. Do you think she had a bad experience in that dress? But, I mean, it's just, like, mindless, you know, and relaxing to me. When people talk about, like, every day for an hour you have to, you know, relax. I mean, I don't know. Some days I don't want to relax at all. I'm on a high and I feel great and I want to keep going. And, you know, other times I get stressed out and I feel like if I get stressed, like, it'll just keep, like, spiraling into, you know, I have a habit of doing that. You know, I'm stressed. Well, let me do more. Well, then I'm getting more stressed. Well, let me do more to make sure that I'm de-stressing myself and accomplishing something. So you have to realize when the spiral is going in the wrong direction. And when that spiral is going in the wrong direction, that's the time to go, you know, sit on eBay or play with the dogs.
I like One King's Lane personally. Uh-huh. I don't know if you've ever tried that.
That's a great one too.
It's a good one. You've given us great, you know, words of wisdom throughout, but I just like to end and just say, if you have one particular piece of advice that has really helped guide you through your career, what would it be?
My mom gave me the best advice, and she said that the best things in life are free. And that has meant so much to me in business situations and personal situations. And I think what she's trying to tell me is that it's not about power, possessions, prestige. It's really about, you know, being with people that you love and doing things that you love. And I think from a career perspective or a personal perspective, that seems to keep me on the right path. When I'm doing something that I love with people that I love, I always know that I'm doing the right thing.
That's terrific. Thank you. It was great to talk to you.